And we start this week with our crosshairs focused on the New York Times, facing questions about its reporting on three big stories over the past 8 days. On October 5th, this breaking news headline on the Times website: U.S. says Navy SEAL team captures Shabab leader in Somalia. The Times cited American officials as their source. Only problem, the story was wrong. When the Times updated the story, it said, quote, the SEAL team was forced to withdraw before it could confirm that it killed the Shabab leader. In a statement to CNN, the Times says its early coverage accurately reflected initial government accounts. Next, this past Thursday, after a meeting between President Obama and House Republican leaders, the Times reported that Obama had rejected a Republican proposal for a short-term debt limit plan. But the White House said no specific determination was made, and many Republicans told CNN the president didn't reject or approve anything. The Times stuck to its story, saying it was, quote, factually accurate and did not require a correction. Said the Times, it was clear that the White House was not going to accept the Republican proposal as offered. Finally, the Times may have tripped on itself over its Thursday story that a CIA warning on suspected NSA leaker Edward Snowden slipped through the cracks when he worked for the agency in Geneva, and that he was returned home because of those concerns. A CIA spokesman said, quote, while we are unable to comment on all the assertions in today's New York Times story on Edward Snowden, the primary allegation of the story is inaccurate on multiple levels. So on Saturday, the Times reported CIA disputes early suspicions on Snowden. But the paper appeared to stand by its earlier report, saying, quote, the Times cited two senior American officials with direct knowledge of the episode. Well, joining me to discuss all of this and to discuss whether the gray lady has gotten a black eye, including is our Ramesh Panuru. He's with us from Chicago. Eleanor Clift, she's from the Daily Beast and joins us here. And Joe Concha from New York. And Joe Concha, I got to start with you here for a minute.
Really?
Because I understand, I'm not going to bury the lead. Congratulations. You had a baby when?
Friday night, 9:26 p.m., 6 pounds. Oh, wow, there she is, Cameron. She got a little beat up in the delivery. 6 pounds, 14 ounces, and hence the pink tie that you're seeing tonight, or today, I should say. We're sticking within theme here, but we couldn't be any more proud. Thank you so much.
Congratulations to you, and all the best, and you're on the journey of your life, I promise you that.
Yeah,
now let me bring you back to the journey we're on here, which is looking at the gray lady and what seems to be some real problems over the past 8 days. How do you explain it?
Well, you know, I'd love to hear Margaret Sullivan explain this, Frank. She is the New York Times public editor. For those keeping score at home, the public editor basically is a publicly identifies errors and omissions and then reports them to the public saying, hey, I think we got this wrong here. I haven't seen one article from Margaret Sullivan saying, hey, we may have made a mistake here, or if we made a mistake, here's why. And the whole reason why you hire a public editor in the New York Times case was probably for a PR move, because it was in light of the whole Jason Blair fiasco about 10 years ago. It begs the question, where is Margaret Sullivan in this whole case, or in these three cases? If you're going to have a policeman on your editorial staff that's supposed to report back to the public why decisions were made or why they weren't made at all this week, Frank.
Well, Joe, let me point out, and I want to make this very clear, and I'm going to make the point as I turn to Eleanor Clift. We invited Margaret Sullivan. We invited Jill Abramson and others from the New York Times. They were either unavailable or they declined. Eleanor, the thing that's most disturbing to many when you see this kind of thing is this attribution to officials, American officials, hanging a very important story, moved in real time. And by the way, CNN, for example, did not report that the Al-Shabaab leader, the Somalia story, that he had been killed in its initial reporting.
Yeah.
But does that trouble you, officials?
Anybody who has reported in Washington understands how difficult it is to get people on the record. Now, American officials is probably the broadest term. That could be just about anybody. So I think, you know, I'm always instructed to try to get the attribution as narrowly as possible, and also to give some indication of the motivation behind whoever the sources are. And so I think, you know, I'm inclined to give the New York Times the benefit of the doubt. They're about the only news organization that still does really deep reporting. And on the so-called error with the reporting of the budget negotiations, I've been covering that. It's like following Rashomon, and you know, I think maybe they shouldn't have said flatly the White House rejected it, but they were never going to settle for a short-term thing that took them right to the holidays. So, you know, is that wrong? Is it right? It's a question of nuance in that case.
No, but nuance matters. And Ramesh Panuru, I want to ask you this, because here's what the Times said when it was clarifying that story on the Obama rejection. It was clear that the White House was not going to accept the Republican proposal as offered. As we did further reporting, we were able to update the story and present a fuller and more nuanced account. Now, this all comes in the middle of very sensitive negotiations. People can take a headline run with it, politicians and posture, and maybe even change a position. Or does it not matter? Is this just part of real-time journalism now?
Well, I think that all media institutions make mistakes. The New York Times' mistakes over the last week aren't even the worst ones that we've seen. The Associated Press made a much bigger blunder this last week. But you've got to correct them. You've got to be upfront with your readers so that people don't think you're pulling a fast one. And I think that's exactly what it looks like they were doing on that debt ceiling story.
You think that looks like they're pulling a fast one, meaning what?
Because, you know, look, I mean, what they're saying is, well, okay, so the administration didn't really explicitly reject it, but it basically rejected it. Well, that's not what they conveyed in their first story. They conveyed something stronger than the truth.
Joe Concha?
Well, I looked at the New York Times Stalin usage manual, as I often do, and one rule they have in there is anonymity is the last resort. And it seems more and more at the New York Times, you always hear from U.S. officials and anonymous sources say, and that leads to one problem. Another one is Twitter. I think we need two editors now at every publication, one for the standard newspaper, all right, which they all have. But then we always see again and again a tweet going out that they want to pull back. And unfortunately, it's like toothpaste. You know, you can't put it back in the tube. And we saw it a couple of weeks ago with Chuck Todd with the Navy Yard shooting. He put out a tweet that he said, oh, actually, it was wrong. And I wonder, did Chuck Todd have to go through the same litmus test with editors to tweet as you would doing a standard report? So I think this is a case of Twitter striking again and really a race to be first instead of to be accurate.
Well, this is one of the big problems now. You've got a race to be first, whether you're tweeting or you're on the air or you're writing in a blog or what, or writing a story. You've got so many demands as a journalist now on you, Eleanor. You're at the Daily Beast. You're doing this. Do you have somebody editing every tweet, every story, every word that you write?
Oh, no, nobody edits the tweets as far as I know.
Nobody edits your tweets?
No. In fact, I say to myself every day, Eleanor, think less, tweet more, because I don't tweet enough.
What do you mean, think less?
Well,
you're really scaring me.
Well, no, you have to kind of trust yourself and put, you know, I don't do it. I mean, I tweet fairly irregularly, but in today's world, we are encouraged to tweet to get our stories out there, promote our colleagues, and if we're analysts and pundits, we should get our thoughts out there. I've never done anything or said anything that's career-ending yet,
Ramesh,
but we're all about two steps away from that, I think.
The cliff gets closer. Ramesh,
you've got to be your own editor.
Anybody edit your tweets?
No. I mean, I think on Twitter, you've just got to be your own editor. It is a medium that really rewards speed even more than all the other ones that we're on. And there's no time for an additional layer of checking. If you can't trust yourself to edit yourself, don't get on Twitter.
Well, there may be a whole new classification of job here. Joe, I want to come back to you for something you said a moment ago about officials and the trouble that you've got with officials. What Eleanor said a few minutes ago and what the New York Times is up against here is they're racing the clock. They've got a huge story. And the fact of the matter is that if you're going to report in this town, you are going to report unnamed officials. There are people who are going to say, protect me on this. You can use the information. I don't even want you to tell them what building I'm in. Are you saying the New York Times shouldn't be doing that?
No. It's going to happen once in a while. I'm just saying it's happening if you go back to the transcript. It's happening more and more, it seems. And I think that is really part of that whole race to be first. But, you know, one more thing I want to point out, Frank, is that there are more media watchdogs out there than ever. I mean, I'm a mediaite. Sure, we do that. But there are conservative blogs out there like Newsbusters that are there to catch the New York Times. It's definitely going to be in the crosshairs because they're the apex of journalism and they're seen as liberal in some circles. So anytime you tweet, anytime you get something wrong, it used to be you issue a correction. Maybe some readers write something to the editor and it gets in the editorial page. Now you make a mistake, everybody sees it, it's reported, and usually some sort of motive is attached to it as well, which may not have been the case here, but that's where we are in 2013. You make a mistake, people are going to know about it.
Okay, well, we've done our bit to help promote that agenda here as well, because we want to make sure that we air what went wrong and the explanations around it.